we move to the Inuit and folk types of bilingualism, where the difference is in the context and circumstance of learner. When we hear or when we see the term illit, it of course refers to someone who is educated and intelligent. Now, for this type of bilingualism, when an individual is acquiring a second language in formal education, which means he or she goes to school and has the foreign language or foreign languages in their curriculum and in their syllabi. When a language or a second language or another language other than our mother tongue is learned in educational settings and informal settings, this or this fact is going to make from the individual intelligent or appear to people as intelligent and therefore well educated and successful in his or her education. That is, he or she has certain achievements in their, let's say, educational courses. So the context of learning a language can be in its formal context, in a very formal education, like in schools or universities or language centers. This is going to be highly evaluated and highly valued and highly perceived by people or by the society or by the speaker himself. However, sometimes we do not learn the language in schools. We do not learn a language in centers. We do not learn the language after courses and attending some lectures and listening to some teachers and so forth. We learn a language by experience. We acquire a second language through contact with its speakers. We learn a language in order to have chances in life. We learn a language because we have to work, we have to have contact, we have to succeed in society, and we have to work for our, let's say, acceptability or in order to be accepted in society. This type of bilingualism or this type of learning a language or the context of learning a language is not formal. It's informal. And it's the needs of the individual and the person that have led him or her to learn this language. Likewise, this type of learning a language does not reflect success in education, but it reflects the social pressure given or employed over a given individual or a speaker. Like the speaker, this means that the speaker has been forced to learn this language in order to work, in order to have contact, in order to, let's say, learn something else, in order to be accepted in labor or in organization and so forth. So like that, we, as opposed to the first one, we are not considered as illit, but rather we are highly stigmatized. That is a person, I mean, not we, but a person or an individual who is learning the second language through just contact, that is not in a formal context, not through education, but just rather through contact with others, and feeling like forced to learn, this bilingual is called a folk bilingual. Not an elite, which is related to, or an elite, which is related to, or who is related to, a successful person in his educational, let's say, career, but rather someone who is socially forced and in a linguistic pressure in order to arrive to a social acceptance. Now, the last difference between, or the last difference that makes the other types of bilingualism is related to language proficiency. And when we talk about proficiency, we relate it to the skills of learning a language. And according to language proficiency, we have different types. If we have equal competence in two languages. That is, if we are bilinguals of Arabic and French, we have equal competence in two languages. Like a native speaker, we can use and control and have command over the two languages freely and in a, let's say, correct, structured, meaningful manner. This type of bilingualism is called balanced bilingualism. That there is a balance between the two languages that we are speaking, that we are using, and that we are possessing in our mental luggage or linguistic background. If this competence is given to one language more than the other one, you see, there is no balance. That is, one is given more importance than the other one. This type of bilingualism is called unbalanced bilingualism, or the speaker is an unbalanced bilingual. Why? Because he has competence over and control over one language more than the other one. Although he can construct sentences and utterances and understand things in the other language, but he has, or he is more competent in one language rather than the other. Now, with regard to the use of skills or the acquisition of skills, if someone, if the individual, we are still at the level of the individual, if the individual is able or has the ability, has the capacity to speak the two languages, speaking, he is a perceptive, or he is a productive bilingual or an active bilingual. That is, he produces, he gives something, he thinks, and then he produces. That there is a kind of processing, there is work in his learning or acquisition of the language. That is, for example, someone can say that I am a bilingual of Arabic and Turkish, and when you say something in Turkish, they say two words and the Salam alaikum. No, it's therefore he can be an active, soi-disant, he can be an active bilingual, but he should speak the two languages in the same way, or he should be a good speaker of the two languages. For example, we as students of English, we are active bilinguals of Arabic, and which is our first language, and English. Why? Because we are learning this language and we are active. There is production. That is, we can speak both languages freely, and we have this ability and the competence of command over the two languages, and much more precisely, the production of the language. And if we can only understand, that is, listen and understand the meaning of the other language or the two languages, then in here the bilingual is a passive one, or is exercising a passive bilingualism. Why passive? Because there is no production in this way, but there is only perception that there is another interlocutor talking to us or producing a language, and we are receiving the two languages. Like that, we are passive bilinguals. So, these are the different types of bilingualism, although if we read about bilingualism, we are going to find a variety of, types of considerations that differ from one linguist to another, and so forth. I tried to classify the types according to what's common among those books and articles, and here we come to the end of our lecture. If you have any question related to this, never hesitate to contact me. And I really hope that we could recognize ourselves through those, types of bilingualism. Now, one can ask himself or herself, which type of bilingual I am, who I am. I am a true bilingual, or an active bilingual, or a passive bilingual, or a simultaneous bilingual, or what are we? These questions are to be answered by each one of us. Thank you very much for your kind attention and see you in other opportunities. Thank you.